Thank you, Megan. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's presentation, Finding Faith in the Maelstrom, Storytelling as a Source of Hope. And it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker. But first, I'm happy to say that the Maelstrom is not that nor'easter. I think a different Maelstrom, and thank you for braving the elements. And I've said a special prayer that the weather cooperates for the next couple hours so we get home safely. Dr. Mary Hess is professor of educational leadership at Luther Seminary, where she has taught since 2000. During the 2016-17 school year, she held the Patrick and Barbara Keenan Visiting Chair in Religious Education at the University of St. Michael's College at the University of Toronto. Dr. Hess has degrees from Yale, Harvard, and that very famous school, Boston College, and has directed a number of projects focusing on the challenges of media culture for communities of faith. As an educator straddling the fields of media studies and religious studies, Dr. Hess has focused her research on exploring ways in which participatory strategies for knowing and learning are constructed and contested amidst digital cultures. Now, I must admit, I didn't write this. I'm not even sure what that sentence means, but we're going to find out. I do have somebody who writes my lines, and it makes me sound smarter than I am. Dr. Hess is particularly interested in dialogic forms of organizational development and the challenges posed to communities by oppressive systems such as racism, classism, sexism, and so on. Dr. Hess publishes regularly in academic journals and is the past president of the Religious Education Association. Her most recent writings include a chapter in Teaching Race, How to Help Students Unmask and Challenge Racism, edited by Stephen Brookfield and on sale at the back table, and as well as a chapter on Global Perspectives on Catholic Religious Education in Schools, edited by Buchanan and Galel. So it's my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Mary Hess, who will speak to us on Finding Faith in Maelstrom, Storytelling as a Source of Hope.
So the spirit was moving and moved my slides ahead a little bit. I want to start from the beginning here. It's okay. It was very ironic, actually, because you said Maelstrom and the slide that said Maelstrom appeared. So first of all, thank you so much. Thank you to the STM for this invitation. It's a really rare privilege to stand in front of you tonight. I want to begin by acknowledging with our Jewish friends that we have just come through the high holy days of Yom Kippur. And I would also like to acknowledge the land upon which we gather this evening. I'd like to acknowledge that the land we are meeting on today is the original homelands of the Mashpee Wampanoag, the Aquinnah Wampanoag, the Nipmuc, and the Massachusett tribal nations. And my apologies if I've gotten that incorrectly pronounced. I ask us to take a moment of silence to acknowledge the painful history of genocide and forced removal from this territory, and to honor and respect the many diverse indigenous people still connected to this land on which we gather. When I first started to think about this lecture more than a year ago, I floated a number of titles past my friends and my fellow religious educators, seeking to discover what might have resonance. Over and over, the sense that we are caught up in a maelstrom kept coming forward. There is something about the particular set of contexts in which we find ourselves that resonates with the metaphor of a maelstrom. Words such as turbulence, turmoil, tumult, disorder, disarray, chaos, confusion, all of these words. Our church, particularly for those of us who are Roman Catholic, remains caught up in the turmoil of the sexual abuse crisis. Our government and politics in the United States are caught up in ideologically driven polarization. Our world is on the brink of climate catastrophe, leading to all manner of refugee crises. The list is long, and I could go on. We are being buffeted on all sides by events, ideas, actions that pressure us into fear, anger, and outrage. I could give an entire lecture focused solely on how it is that digital tech is contributing to this maelstrom, but here I want to invite you to consider this particular image. I want you to note the light at the very heart of it. As Lin-Manuel Miranda once saying, in the eye of the hurricane, there is quiet. I'm convinced that now more than ever, our contemplative practices hold power and resilience amidst this maelstrom. We need to find ways to listen more carefully, to open ourselves up to the still point, which creates room for us to hear God. Religious educators need to be at the center of this work. That's what I want to talk to you about tonight. Finding the still point in the center of the maelstrom through hearing, sharing, creating more intentionally our stories. I'm firmly convinced that there's hope in the midst of this whirlwind, hope to be found in the midst of our fear and our anger. Yet that hope requires careful, disciplined listening to God, to ourselves, to each other. It requires new practices and the retrieval of ancient ones. It requires a different kind of curriculum, one that I think might appropriately be called martyria. But before I get there, let me begin by situating myself and highlighting some dynamics of the context we inhabit. So my primary appointment is at a seminary where we are preparing pastoral leaders, and I also teach in university and K-12 settings here in North America. I speak tonight from that specific location, and I hope that I will ignite your curiosity and evoke your own experiences as we engage these challenges, but I'm not seeking to be prescriptive or definitive. Digital media shape the world we live in, and we no longer live in a world in which young people are guaranteed the option of growing up within a faith-enriched space. Our socialization, our religious formation, if you will, takes place far more often, and for many people more strongly, in the midst of digital cultural flows. A key concept which has emerged within digital cultural studies is something which anthropologist Michael Wesch has identified as context collapse. I imagine you all know, as religious educators, or more broadly, as people of faith, how important context is to meaning. Yet in many of the places we inhabit today, context is collapsing. Perhaps you've had the experience yourself of saying something clearly in one setting, only to hear it come back to you, picked up and tweeted out from some other space, absent the original context, and perhaps even contradictory to your meaning. For some people, a primary response to this challenge has been to retreat from digital media as much as possible, to hide behind the figuratively closed doors and strong walls of like-minded settings. I think of some of my Lutheran friends whose favorite hymn, "A mighty fortress is our God," has become their slogan for such a retreat. But here's the thing. I believe God is contributing to be present in all that we are and see and do and breathe. I was thoroughly caught by the Jesuits to see God in all things when I was here. I have spent much of the last 20 years since I studied at BC attempting to do just that. And in the process, I have come to see how essential it is to learn how to see context, how to build context, essentially how to recontextualize faith. Story is at the heart of that process. We know who we are in part by the stories we tell ourselves and the stories others tell about us. We know who we are in relation to God in large measure by the stories we share. Building context requires storying faith. I think this is probably an old insight here at BC. I know I have been deeply shaped by the scholars in this place. Thomas Groom, of course, taught me much about the shared praxis of faith. Mary Boyce helped me to deepen that understanding by inviting me to notice the ways in which we as Catholics have told our story in ways that have been deeply destructive to our Jewish neighbors. Brinton Likes helped me to notice that we can open ourselves to justice and listen more deeply to stories told through photo voice, through images. John McDarg encouraged me to hear the stories of other traditions in resonance with my own. Roberto Guazzetta reminded me that a universal story can be found evocatively in a particular story. Marianne Hinsdale taught me the power of theme-centered interaction as a context builder. And Sean Copeland kept me faithfully in the Catholic community by modeling how dissenting stories and radical presence can shape our communities. Each of these scholars has been thoroughly steeped in and are responsive to how we story our faith. Context is essential in that process. Consider this image. In 2D, you can see how shining a light from one angle will convince you that this is a square, and from a different angle that this is a circle. Both perspectives are true in limited ways. Seeing this image in 3D makes that clear, yet the whole of this image is much more, and even now we're only seeing a drawing in a 2D representation of a 3D cylinder. We are seeing, we are knowing truth, but it is and can only ever be in our humanness an incomplete truth. Context is essential, and context is collapsing. The advent of digital media and the metaphors that we use to make sense of them have caused us to fall into specific epistemological traps ever more quickly. The trap of objectivity, which believes that reality can be known fully by careful observation and all knowledge is out there on the World Wide Web to be discovered and consumed, the trap of objectivity leads us to the hubris of human power. The trap of subjectivity, which believes that reality can never be known apart from our individual perceptions, and which leads us into believing that we can and must rely only on what our experience tells us, the trap of subjectivity leads us away from transcendence. Given the ever smaller target markets into which digital media draw us, algorithmic enclaves can trap us into a form of relativism which can easily create others whom we denigrate, deny, and eventually even to whom we deal death. We need a third way, a path beyond either a concrete materialism which refuses transcendence or a naive relativism which centers on individuals. I'm convinced that that path leads through story. Stories are key to context. In the fire hose of information that is sprayed at us every day and in the midst of the rancor, the polarization, and even the hatred found there, how are we to know which stories to listen to? How are we to know which stories have value? For most people, the answers to those questions begin in whether or not they believe those stories are manipulating them. Is a story authentic? Does it come from someone they trust? Then perhaps it's credible. But the problem is that when we move quickly, which digital media are wired to do, we often do not ask basic questions. And moving quickly also means we rely on past experiences to focus our attention, often in ways of which we are entirely unaware. We know from media scholars that the three dynamics that have shifted the most rapidly in the midst of the maelstrom we call digital media are authority, authenticity, and agency. We know from scholars who study narratives that a key element in whether a narrative is engaged seriously is the extent to which it, quote, rings with authenticity. If it does, then it can feel authoritative to people. Authenticity shapes authority. But so do does something we might call agency. Agency is the ability to make things happen, and it is deeply wound up with power. As Irshad Manji has written, power is the capacity to set expectations about what should be and to translate those expectations into what will be. Some of our most powerful stories have to do with personal agency. Of course, in a world dominated by the fracturing of stories, by the collapsing of contexts, often that agency is only understood in individual terms. And even then, only in terms of the kind of consumption that it affords. Can you buy something? Then perhaps you have agency. Can you give money to a candidate? Then perhaps you have agency. But what can we actually do in the midst of this maelstrom? What kind of agency might we have, for instance, in the sexual abuse crisis in the church? How far does personal agency go in terms of climate catastrophe? The stories that are far more rare have to do with collective agency. Think about the organizational structures we have built that have to do with a community doing something together. Churches, schools, firefighters, legal processes that use juries, unions within businesses, co-ops. All of these institutions are finding it harder and harder to make a go of it, at least in the U.S. Yes, there are some communities that still have robust public schools. I'm grateful for that. And some communities with large churches. But there's much less of such shared agency all around us. And of course, also much less representation of it. Think for a moment of the last several movies you've gone to or the last several shows you've watched streaming. Just think. I won't ask you to share it out, but pause for 10 seconds and think about what you've watched recently. Here are some of the shows I've been watching. Jane the Virgin, Carnival Row, The Good Place, The Discovery of Witches. Even as I say these titles, I'm struck both by how little they represent collective agency and also by how each of these shows has some elements of religion in it. Okay, I'm a religion scholar. Of course, shows with religious themes might appeal to me, but aside from The Good Place, which is ostensibly about heaven, but really has almost no religion in it, none of these shows is about religion, and yet, each of them tells stories in which a force more than human is active in some way. And in each of these examples, there are people with religious beliefs and practices, some more malevolent than others. I'm still captured by the fact in Carnival Row, that in the religious institutions, the image in all of them is of a hanged man. It's very disturbing. And of course, my Jewish friends say to me, well, isn't Christ on the cross disturbing? Well, that image has become so familiar that it doesn't do it to me the same way this hanging man does. These stories hold a nascent, just emerging sense of something beyond individual agency. But what kind of transcendent agency is it? Mostly a mysterious force with little to commend it to us. So let me summarize for a moment here. Authority, authenticity, agency, but in particular agency that's individual, rarely collective, and even more rarely representing transcendent agency. We live in an era of context collapse. We live in an era where agency is understood in very individualist terms. Can you see the conundrum? So much of what we want to teach in religious education pushes back against these dominant stories. We want to invite awareness of relationship with transcendence. We want to shape practice in collective ways. We want to give people access to a religious tradition and make manifest that tradition is always in the process of transformation. And yes, that's my dissertation director, Mary Boyce's definition of religious ed. So how are we best to do this in the midst of the maelstrom? We need to walk a third path. Neither objectivism nor relativism, but rather one of relational knowing. This is the path which Parker Palmer long ago labeled a community of truth. Maybe some of you know this image. Whose are we? God's. We know as we are known by God. It is God's agency to which we need to witness. This is a relational form of knowing. Not a relativist one, but a relational one. Not an objectivist one, but a relational one. And as religious educators, we must be alive to what it means to educate within this relationship. And in practices which strengthen our awareness of and reliance on God. This is a difficult challenge for many reasons, but for one in particular, in the midst of digitally infused spaces, and that is that being God's, means we must acknowledge God's agency. Part of what is so seductive and engaging about digital media is that for many of us, it's a place of great creative personal agency. Unlike 30 years ago, when to publish or broadcast something globally, you needed enormous capital. Now with just a few $100s, which admittedly is an amount still beyond some people, you can float something out into the world globally. I grew up with vinyl records, shows you how old I am, and learned how to make mixtapes using cassettes. But back then, copying from a record onto a cassette degraded the music in the process, so while I had some agency in making a musical landscape to inhabit, it often lacked clarity. Today, I can not only create playlists with global reach, they have digital clarity with no degrading from one copy to the next, which tangentially, is a huge issue around sharing of ideas and copyright, but again, that's a lecture for another day. Even more so, I can take music I love and combine it with images and words and share them out into the world. It is in these spaces, spaces of music, of images, of text, and increasingly, given VR and AR capacities, of movement, that people are coming to know themselves and each other. There's enormous promise here, but enormous peril as well. As Michael Wesch, the anthropologist I mentioned earlier, notes, we live in an era in which digital media invite an expansive engagement with human being, a kind of freedom to connect, unlike anything we've ever experienced. But it is also a space in which the public performance of hatred is being honed and extended. Context is essential, but context is collapsing. We know relationally, and we need to know within a relationship with God. How are we to teach and learn in ways that suggest learning context more deeply and recontextualizing is the heart of what we need to do? Most of you are probably familiar with Maria Harris's lovely articulation of five forms of curriculum in religious communities: kerygma, koinonia, didache, liturgia, diakonia. I want to remind us of yet another kind or form, that of martyria. You can see the root of that word in our word for martyr. But I'd ask you to focus on the heart of what martyria is, that is witness or testimony. We need to inhabit this kind of curriculum more than ever in the fraught places we find ourselves, in the midst of context collapse, in the midst of the maelstrom in which we're being tossed, in order to find the still point at the center, in order to listen for God more effectively. We need a curriculum of martyria. We need witnesses. We need testimony. And when we talk about testimony, we need to talk about trauma. Trauma is described as an encounter with death. This encounter is not, however, a literal death, but a way of describing a radical event or events that shatter all that one knows about the world and all the familiar ways of operating within it. The ongoing crisis of child and, frankly, adult abuse in our church is trauma. Climate catastrophe is trauma. White supremacy and white nationalism are trauma. Sometimes we forget, at least those of us who live in the privileged places of white middle-class culture frequently forget, that at the heart of Christian witness is an executed God. Divine love is revealed at the point at which it is most threatened. This is Shelley Rambo. By the way, the slides, which you can get to from my handout, anything that's underlined is an active link to the citation. Theologians have begun to explore how trauma invites differing interpretations of Scripture, and Shelley Rambo in particular has offered a profoundly thoughtful engagement with the work of Hans Urs von Balthasar and the Gospel of John. She invites us to consider the period between the crucifixion and the resurrection, what many of us call Holy Saturday, that time during which, in the Apostles' Creed, we confess Jesus descended into hell. In contrast to the traditional interpretation of what it means to be a witness and to testify, much of which has focused on the witnessing to the resurrection of the Christ, Rambo invites us to ponder that earlier moment in the Paschal mystery, to remain in that place. She then asks us to consider whether witnessing in that place of remaining might be understood as sustained by the Spirit. Trauma is described as an encounter with death. This encounter is not, however, a literal death, but a way of describing a radical event or events that shatter all that one knows about the world and all the familiar ways of operating within it. Witnessing the suffering that remains involves encountering the ways in which death pervades life. It entails attesting to the temporal distortions and epistemological ruptures of an experience that exceeds a radical yet ending, yet has no pure beginning. In the work I do on dismantling racism, on finding places and ways and moments in which we might encounter each other across vast diversities and systemic oppressions, people tell me that the most powerful thing I can do is see them, hear them, believe them. I see you. I hear you. I believe you. These words are powerful when we're listening to people who have been abused by our church. They are powerful when we embody them in listening to people experiencing police brutality. They are powerful, in the words of our Indigenous partners, when we can see, hear, and believe beyond the human and into deep creation. What we hear is painful, often painful beyond our ability to be open to the hearing. And that's the work of the Holy Spirit as well. Shelley Rambo describes a middle place of remaining, a place in which the utter abandonment of Jesus' descent into hell is not forgotten or too quickly moved through. This is a space of silence. It may even be a place of such silence that God's word in Christ is silent there. This is the place of which Rambo speaks when she invites us to see, again, that divine love is revealed at the point at which it is most threatened. God experiences within God's inner life the forsakenness of those in hell. Speaking of the Spirit as breath, Rambo reminds us the Spirit's exhale and inhale, if interpreted from the middle, suggest a movement that exceeds death and yet precedes the event of life that resurrection narrates. This breath powers a testimony to what is unknown and unaccounted for. This breath powers witness to what is unsaid, unspoken, and inaccessible through language. Witnessing in this space between death and life, those who stand there experience the inarticulable terrain of middleness. Witnessing what cannot be contained within speech, they demonstrate a unique relationship to language. When we find ourselves in this place, when we open ourselves to what Parker Palmer has called the tragic gap, our hearts will be broken. The only question might be, will they be broken open or broken into shards? I think that it's no coincidence that in a world which is swirling in pain and oppression and catastrophic climate shifts, in hundreds of thousands of refugees fleeing violence, in a world thoroughly suffused with trauma, that into this world, Pope Francis speaks a word of mercy. Younger people know this world well. And when we consider the statistics, rising suicide rates, high unemployment and indebtedness, fewer and fewer young people interested in religion, now is the time to think about what the core of our witnessing is really about. Banal expressions of disembodied love have little place in witnessing. So too cheery voicings of hope. But there are ways of witnessing. Processes of testimony, expressions of what O'Neill Van Horn calls dark hope that can be evocative for people today. A first step is learning to listen carefully to ourselves, to each other, to all of creation, and this is where a curriculum of martyria emerges. This curriculum is one of testimony, testimony from the heart of the maelstrom. As Rebecca Chopp has written, testimonies describe the real in ways that require people to see these events that reason and theory do not count, do not authorize, do not signify. Testimonies challenge us to reimagine theory as the language that serves the fragments, the uneasy nature, the words against words in order to describe the real. Really seeing, really hearing, really believing, these are central to testimony. And testimony of this kind needs to be supported by a curriculum that invites it, which means a curriculum of relational knowing, a curriculum open to finding the still point at the heart of the maelstrom. want to take a moment and in the midpoint of this lecture to note the lyrics of a song we recently sang in liturgy in my worshiping community, a song written by Bex Gaunt and Adam Tice. Listen to these words. Faith abides through honest questions. Faith grows strong through doubt and fear. Faith finds grace in imperfections. Faith abides, for God is here. Hope delights with expectation. Hope makes hidden pathways clear. Hope inspires resilient action. Hope abides, for God is here. Love will not leave us forsaken. Love receives each falling tear. Love restores what death has taken. Love abides, for God is here. Bex and Adam are quite young as composers and poets go, but they're naming here a key element of what it means to know God. God is here, precisely at the heart of our doubt and our questions. God is here in the midst of our pain, and the reality that God is here means that we can inhabit our questions. We can face our fears. We can, as yet another hymn we often sing puts it, ask to be, quote, shepherded beyond our wants, beyond our fears, from death into life. We can and we must educate in ways that invite critical consciousness, that help us to name the brokenness in our midst, whether that's a church which refuses to ordain women, a church which remains deeply divided by racism, a church which has abused countless numbers of vulnerable people, children and adults alike. And in doing so, we must also educate in ways that witness to a God who joins us in the midst of our pain, a God who poured God's self into the world, who became incarnate in that most vulnerable of human beings, a child born in a stable, a child born to a dark-skinned, unmarried mother, a child who became a refugee. This is the God who poured God's self into our vulnerabilities and draws us through them into love. Our contemplative practices can help us to do this. They are now an essential element of the curriculum of Martyria. At the still point of the maelstrom, in the quiet at its heart, there we encounter God. But there our words often fail us. As Maggie Ross notes, we need to learn the practices of silence. The basic messages of those who have done the work of silence consist in this. If self-consciousness makes us human, then its elision opens the door to what was once called divinity. The choice for silence or noise, for carefulness or carelessness, is ours in every moment. To choose silence as the mind's default in an accelerating consumer culture, a culture that sustains itself by dehumanizing people through the unrelenting pressure of clamor, confusion, and commodification, is indeed a subversive act. But of course, we are thoroughly surrounded by stories, by imaginings, by noise. Ross, quoting Bringhurst, writes, "Narrative means much more than telling stories. It means learning how to hear them, however, how to nourish them, and how to let them live. It means learning to let stories swim down into yourself, grow large there, and rise back up again. It does not, repeat, does not mean memorizing the lines so you can act the script you've written or recite the book you've read." Part of why I believe it's so difficult for many people to find themselves in religious community, particularly institutional forms of religious community, is that there are so many stories out there already in which we can experience this kind of process. We can immerse ourselves in powerful stories that swim down into ourselves, grow large, and rise back up again. The challenge in the midst of trauma, in the midst of the maelstrom, is that many, many of these stories appear to be more experientially effective at eliciting the resonance of this kind of dark hope than do our Christian narratives. We can no longer dwell only in the quadrant of theological imagination that takes as central the dominant framing of Christ's life and redemptive power as one of atonement or sacrifice. We need to express what we feel, what we hear, what we believe as we journey through Holy Saturday. We must witness to the Spirit, to the drop of love that comes from the wounds of Christ's crucifixion, we must tell the stories of at-one-ment. Trauma brings with it broken memory and experiences that may not be able to be experienced in words. To be broken open instead of only into shards, we must be able to lean into healing. We must bring to religious education a curriculum of witness, of testimony, of martyria. But this witnessing must be authentic. It must dwell in the silences. It must find ways to offer testimony that go beyond words. And it is, of course, somewhat ironic that I'm speaking to you about silence. So perhaps now would be a good moment to take a minute of silence and simply breathe. So I invite you to just pay attention to your breath for just a minute. Witnessing demands a relationship to life that exceeds the boundaries of logic. Instead, witness requires an imaginative capacity, a capacity to imagine beyond an ending, to imagine life where it is not, in the face of the impossibility of a future. Many of us, particularly those who inhabit dominant spaces, have no practice with this kind of witnessing, or even with the kind of listening that can bring it to the surface. I've spent much of the last decade, and particularly the last 2 years, working to help people find ways to listen to each other. Without practice, without even any representation of what it can mean to listen in this deep way, how do we expect anyone to be able to do so? A curriculum of martyria, of testimony, of witnessing is at heart about story, but we have to be careful and thoughtful about our stories. As Bell et al. Make clear, stories can fall into at least 4 categories. Stock or dominant stories that often silence all others. Concealed stories, told in the interstices of dominant ones. Resistant stories that begin to break the hold of the dominant stories. And counter stories. A curriculum of testimony seeks to break open the dominant stories and invite the concealed stories into open air. I believe that what has happened, or at least is beginning to happen, as we listen to the stories of abuse survivors in the church, is this kind of openness. As we listen to the stories of all creation burning in the midst of climate change, we are beginning to hear the concealed stories. Now we must build resistance stories and ultimately draw on the counter stories of the gospel of Jesus Christ. When you are living in the middle, in the remaining, in the holy Saturday of not knowing, it can be incredibly comforting to step into a space in which every one of your biases is confirmed and your beliefs are never questioned. But living fully in a world as complex as ours is, living with the intention of justice and mercy does not lead to comfort. Rather, a deeper comfort, a darker hope, rises from seeing the edges, seeing the parabolic in the heart of the mythic, to use Anderson and Foley's words. A couple of years ago, I had the privilege of hearing Monsignor Fisichello, the president of the Pontifical Council for the New Evangelization, speak. I was deeply moved by his emphasis on accompaniment and on the necessity of listening closely. I took careful notes because I was so moved by what he had to say. Among other things, he said, Pope Francis speaks of pastoral conversion. What does this mean? It means something about changing the lives of our communities, which have become more or less bureaucratic community, to a missionary-minded community. It needs to be a church that is outgoing first, not asking people to come to us, but to be outgoing on the way outwards. We are reaching out to everybody without excluding anyone. I emphasize this because often we do exclude certain ones. We make a judgment, whereas it should be welcome. Welcome should be the first criteria, the first principle by which we act. The church is becoming aware again that it is missionary by nature, apostolic, and the church wishes to exclude no one. Our communities need to become a community of persons in relationship with each other who are able to walk alongside people, pointing out, and I would say searching together, for the meaning of our lives together. It's the president of the Council for the New Evangelization. One of the aspects of this kind of accompaniment of which Fisichella speaks, and to which we need to attend, particularly those of us who inhabit positions of privilege in various hierarchies of power, is that listening is about vulnerability. When you ask a genuine question, when you express authentic wonder, you are situating yourself in a stance of openness. You are making yourself vulnerable to learning. Yet we are immersed in so much trauma, whether that comes from displacement, from oppression, from war, from the climate, again, endless possibilities. But trauma is an experience from which people often learn how to avoid vulnerability. The deep shame of our church right now, the reality that we have perpetrated evil in the name of hierarchical order, in the ways in which we have not listened carefully to children, let alone to women and men, this deep shame means that we continue to perpetuate trauma throughout our spaces. We need to find ways to move into relational knowing that draws on our authentic pain, that listens carefully to our trauma, and in the midst of that remaining, hears the voice of the Spirit offering hope. Here is where agency is so essential, and not simply because our culture celebrates personal agency so strongly, but because planted deeply within us is a yearning for collective agency and for agency resting in God. Our primary focus, one of our primary forms of agency right now, instead of being about consumption, need to be turned to creation. Gracie Olmsted wrote recently, reflecting on the climate catastrophe, that the act of creation is opposed to the act of consumption. The latter suggests that everything exists to serve our needs and appetites, but the other reminds us of the value and goodness inherent in things themselves, and how creation encourages stewardship and responsibility. So how can storytelling be a source of hope amidst the maelstrom? It begins in an act of creation rather than consumption. We confess God first and foremost as creator of all that has been, all that is, all that will be. We confess Jesus as God sharing God's self into the world, pouring God's self into the finite, fractured human context that we inhabit. And we confess the Holy Spirit as advocate, comforter, source of our belief. So, create, share, believe. And we know in religious education that this is a reciprocal, mutual, indwelling process. We can enter this circle as religious educators through any of these doors, but far too often we've confined ourselves solely to the portal of belief, and we have worried about getting our beliefs right. Orthodoxy. Or as some scholars have noted, believe so that you might belong. And yet, we are learning that inviting people to create, inviting them to find ways to tell their own stories and then to hone them in a circle practice amidst communal sharing and adding layers of meaning with sound and image, when we invite people to create in this way, they slow down. They listen, they focus, they attend to their stories in ways that are incredibly fruitful and incredibly powerful. Indeed, doing this kind of creative work inevitably shapes belief. And once you've created something that you care about, you want to share it. So an entry point for religious educators that takes the curriculum of martyria seriously in this day and age needs to begin in creation. It needs to begin in learning the processes that help us to slow down and focus, to attend, to contemplate what is being birthed in our midst. A word of caution here, we are not God, and we do not create out of nothingness. The process of sharing one's story, of listening to other stories, needs to be carefully shaped so that we are indeed able to listen deeply. So I want to offer two streams to participate in listening deeply. A stream that listens carefully in the midst of popular digital culture, and a stream that listens carefully within our own creativity. When we turn to popular culture, we need to turn with exquisitely tuned ears, ever mindful of the spaces in which we are listening. Far too many of us have lived a rushed, ever busy, overwhelmed kind of day-to-day life. We access our news via our so-called smart devices. We turn to our friends and our social media streams for authoritative interpretations, and yet we rarely question the confines of those streams. Scholars are helping us to see that the very algorithms behind these digital spaces are leading us ever more deeply into polarization. The goal of most digital streams is your attention. If you are not paying for that stream, you are the product. If it's free digital tech, you are the product. And these algorithms generate revenue by evoking anger, fear, outrage, far more effectively than when they privilege beauty, awe, wonder. But we can be more intentional about these streams. Again, a lecture for another day. But here I want to invite you into a short exercise in listening to a piece of popular culture. Television commercials are often great resources for this kind of listening because the best of them are crafted by enormously creative artists and they seek to evoke some of our deepest yearnings. Of course, then they want to attach them to other things, but we can think more deeply about that. So we can ask, what is the yearning here? And then we can offer a different response, a creative response to that yearning. So try this one. Watch this commercial and think about what it's evoking. Grocery store. For just a moment, for a few moments of silence, think about whether there's a biblical story, a liturgical practice, or some other explicitly religious connection you might make to this commercial story. And I'm not going to ask you to share it right now. We can do that in Q&A, but just take a moment and think for yourself, does anything get evoked as you watch that story? Perhaps later in the Q&A we can talk about this, but for now I'll note that on the back of the handout, there's a process for working through this kind of listening, along with a link to a number of commercials that work really well with it. So over and over again, I've used this kind of exercise to invite people into a different kind of creative listening, a different kind of testimony amidst popular culture. So this is one exercise in a curriculum of witness of testimony of martyria. But there's another stream that is, in my experience, even more powerful and deeply connected to the dark hope I mentioned earlier. And that's a stream, a form of this curriculum of testimony tied to our own very personal stories. Decades ago, the Center for Digital Storytelling was birthed in the midst of the community theater movement. I have my own memories of what can come to life amidst community theater, and indeed Frank Rogers, whose book, Finding God in the Graffiti, is on the back table, and also on your handout, explores at length how to engage in that form of religious education. But here I want to note that the Center for Digital Storytelling noticed how profound it could be to take stories birthed in the midst of improvisational community and record them, adding images and music to them, layering meaning upon meaning upon meaning, opening up the complexity and depth of human experience. Digital storytelling, understood in this way, is a workshop-based participatory media practice focused on self-representation. This is a kind of storytelling that creates spaces in which people listen very closely to their own and to each other's stories, helping to bring them to birth and then sharing them out into ever wider spaces. I want to return to something I mentioned earlier when talking about trauma. In the quiet spaces, in the still spaces, in the brokenhearted near silence of remaining, in the profound anguish of Holy Saturday, comes a whisper of dark hope, comes a deep love from the wounds of Christ, comes the Spirit to sustain in our hope. As Shelley Rambo reminds us, divine power and presence takes the form of witness. God sees us. God hears us. God believes us. In the midst of the trauma that is climate catastrophe all around us, Joanna Macy has long lifted up a word of hope. Her words come back to me now in this way. We are changing all the time. You become what you love. You're always asked to sort of stretch a little bit more, but actually we're made for that. There's a song that wants to sing itself through us, and we've just got to be available. Maybe the song that is sung through us is a most beautiful requiem for an irreplaceable planet. Or maybe it's a song of joyous rebirth as we create a new culture that doesn't destroy its world. But in any case, there's absolutely no excuse for our making our passionate love for our world dependent on what we think of its degree of health, whether we think it's going to go on forever. We can remind each other of this. We can listen for the song that is being sung within us and learn how to share it out just a bit more. Telling our stories in this way, finding the song that wants to be sung within us, is at the heart of digital storytelling as a source of hope. I want to offer one example here to make it more concrete. This is a digital story that was created in a workshop during a Religious Education Association meeting. Annabelle Prophet, the creator of the story, has given me permission to share it, and I offer it to you as an example of what digital storytelling as a form of faith formation can look like. I want to note that in your handout, there are two exercises for how you would do that storytelling first in a circle long before you'd make it digital. But here's an example.
I grew up on Wonder Bread. It was what my family could afford. One loaf could feed our family far more inexpensively than a designer loaf from a bakery. Peanut butter and jelly, bologna with mayonnaise. But over the years, I've come to disdain cheap white bread as unhealthy, and, I'm ashamed to admit, lower class fare. So that day, I was dismayed to see the slices of white bread laid out on the communion table in our seminary chapel. Could anything feel more incongruent with the soaring Gothic architecture of the chapel that represented my high church leanings? Usually, we used beautiful homemade loaves of crusty, wholesome grains when we served communion. I sat in my pew, conflicted, trying to figure out why this felt so disturbing. I loved the sacrament of communion. I just didn't love this bread. It was as though my child self was in that pre-sliced white bread, and I didn't know what to do with that. Then it came to me. I had only been permitted to start taking communion when I was 13 years old. I'd never been permitted to bring my child self to the table. But that day in the seminary chapel, that wonder bread on the table ushered my child self in and invited her to partake of the grace offered at this holy meal. As we went forward to receive the bread, I reached out my hand, and as the server said, "This is the body of Christ, broken for you," the broken places of my childhood seemed to inhabit that small piece of torn white wonder bread. Brokenness shared, somehow, has healing power. I'll never look at wonder bread the same way.
This kind of testimony is born in careful attention to one's own story, then honed through participation in a shared story circle, only then shared out into the wider world. This is a form of active contemplation. It's a process, a part of the curriculum of testimony. Just as I do not believe it's coincidence that Pope Francis is speaking of mercy, a response to painful testimony, it's also no coincidence that Franciscan Richard Rohr's daily devotions are so widely shared. Here's a quote from one of his pieces 2 weeks ago. He's quoting Catherine Nerney. "This kind of mutual interdependence I sense to be true. We live in and through one another. We become ourselves only in and through a process of mutual interbecoming. It all began in God's own creative, self-giving love. Much deeper than the inevitability of my physically resembling my earthly mother is the reality of my core identity, the core identity of all who bear the same family resemblance, a unique but related face of compassion. The same divine love has birthed us all. God will never be dead as long as we're alive." The song that wants to be sung through us is a song that is interconnected and interdependent. I want to close this evening by having us sing together. I realize that this is a risk, precisely because of context collapse. I have no idea if this song will resonate with anyone here, but it's a song that's been floating through my heart the whole time I've been working on this lecture, and it's a song we've been singing in liturgy at my church a lot lately. It's also written by the young artists I mentioned earlier, Bex Gaunt and Adam Tice. So I hope you might risk even standing up right now, as you are able, and singing it with me as a reminder of God's presence in the midst of the maelstrom. In God's child. In the good times, in the hard times, God will be with you. Stay with you. Thank you. Thank you so much. And now we're going to prompt you with a question, so please be seated. And we're going to give you a minute or two to think about it. And then I believe we're going to talk to each other. And then we're going to talk as a whole group. So this was at least the question I was curious about, but there may be other things you want to say to each other. Where have you experienced a curriculum of martyria, and what was learning like in the midst of it? So please have a chance to chat with your neighbor for a little bit. Okay, I think we're going to try to bring this into a more shared space. And we have two mics. Where are the two mics? There's one right there, and there's one right there. So who would like to say something? Could be a response, it could be a question, but please do it with the mic so that they can record it. Might be something you've heard and you're talking to each other.
I just had a question about something you had said earlier in your presentation. Could you expand on the statement, believing to belong, and how it contributes or detracts from true faith?
Ah, right. So I think we have a tendency, those of us who've been religious educators for a long time, to think that entering into community is about first understanding what it is you're believing before you enter into the community, right? Which of course is not exactly what the catechumenate was way, way back in the beginning, but it has been not just for religious communities, but lots of other organizations too. People like Elizabeth Drescher, who I think has taught here, in the summer, one of the things that she's learned in her research, and one of the things that certainly media scholars argue, is that these days, people tend to choose to belong by participating and then deciding if that's really what they want to do, right? So they participate in order to belong and then eventually to believe. And I think if you have a relational notion of truth, so that's back to the epistemological thing I kind of skipped over quickly, where the soundbite for that would be the more diverse the knowers, the more robust the knowing. If you work from that kind of angle, then having multiple ways into an experience and a truth will give you more robust truth. And I think that we have actually a lot of examples of that. We just have sometimes not paid attention to them. I think about the early debates over getting involved in interfaith work, and the theory was you had to know your own tradition really well before you ventured into discussion with somebody else's. And of course, what we're learning is that kids grow up in a multi-faith world. They have lots of curious questions. What we want to do is ignite their curiosity, curate good materials for them, and help them practice, right? And that often, that igniting of curiosity comes from engaging across kinds of things. We need a mic over there.
Thank you, Mary. I mean, as I was listening to you, it was great to, I mean, admire your invitation into reclaiming the communal, you know, the communal dimension of religious education, and particularly this curriculum of martyria. And what I'm curious, and this is more than a question, it's more of a reflection or a comment, is I wonder if we live in a society, you know, where we understand the grammar, or we can understand the grammar of martyria, you know, that idea of eating together. I mean, we're raising an entire generation right now in which eating together is not part of the people's lives, you know. We live in a society in which we spend our times distracted, you know, with our phones, computers, and many. And I mean, I love that idea of the narratives and the stories and telling the stories. You know, I mean, Armando here is working on the, you know, his doctoral work is on listening to the stories of immigrants, you know, and how they make meaning. And the question for me is, who's going to listen to those stories? Who's going to listen to, where is the community that interprets and listens, and not only that, but understands, you know, those narratives out there, so we can make something out of them, you know? So that's, I think that's what religious educators are encountering as a challenge. We all are encountering as a challenge as we move forward. And we got this kind of, this generational gap, you know? Many of them raised, you know, in that world in which we actually ate together because our parents made us eat together, and because, you know, we live in those contexts in which, you know, in this interpersonal, there was a common grammar.
Right. Yeah. Well, one of the things I would say back to you, first of all, you know very deeply in the Latinx community that there are still vestiges of collective and communal ways of being. And that's true in lots of different communities. It's not the dominant stock story is the problem that you're talking to right now. And I think that Elizabeth's research, a lot of people's research, so Elizabeth has these four things she talks about, right? Food, friends, family, and Fido. Fido stands in for pets. But she talks about what she's observed. She's done all these interviews with people who claim the label spiritual but not religious. I think there's a very deep yearning. I think there's a very deep hunger. I think people actually want to find ways and times to do this. But we have bought into the dominant stories to such an extent that we have lost some of the practices. And this, of course, is where religious educators who are deeply steeped can offer openings, can offer practices. But I think we've had a tendency, as I said, to focus more on the belief part of that circle. We focus more on the, you know, getting the stuff right, getting the orthodoxy right, getting the, and we've been unwilling or unable to acknowledge the trauma at the heart of all of this. That was what I was maybe not very clear about, what trying to draw into is when you listen deeply to each other and you really hear and see each other, community forms. There's an awful lot that makes it hard, especially with the dominant stock stories. And that's why I like the bell et al., you know, the stock or dominant, concealed, resistant, counter stories categories, because it helps us think about what kinds of stories are we listening to and sharing. The thing about eating together is fascinating to me. One of the things about television commercials is that they are often eliciting a yearning, right? So there's a yearning that's there, and then they attach it to a product that you can consume. This commercial for a grocery store, so what's it going to attach it to is food, right? But it has a lot of resonance in a lot of settings in which I've shown it, and I think it's because people are hungry for that. If we could figure out how to manage our time, which is to say how to recognize stillness, how to create some room for the quiet that makes it possible to listen, that's, you know, and we do, and I have to say, so I'm on the faculty of a seminary who just launched a program in which we take our 4-year degree and squish it into two, and all the same stuff. And I'm as I say, a friendly skeptic of this process, because I'm not convinced that it gives room for precisely learning those kinds of practices. But, you know, I've been in so many settings in which basically people want permission to let go of the competitive stuff. They want permission to not have to be caught up in all of that. And if you can create spaces that make that possible for them, then they flood to them, actually. So I would say I learned this mostly from other communities, Latinx communities, Somali communities in the Twin Cities, the Hmong community, which still cherishes collective knowing. Do we have a mic?
There are different communities, even though you sit down, you don't sit down and eat together. My favorite is driving the car, driving child number one with child number two. We all have a chance to talk together, and maybe it's the only time that child number two gets to talk with child number one without child three and four there. Mm-hmm. So we're bonding together and learning from each other, and we weren't sitting down eating, we were taking advantage and recognizing that this is an opportunity.
That's a lovely example. And one of my colleagues, Rich Melheim, has done a lot of work on car conversations, on precisely that. Because he's watched how families operate and where are the spaces where there's room. And the interesting thing about car conversations is that you're often not looking at each other, because the person is driving and the kid is behind. But there's something important about that. The story exercise, one of the exercises on the handout, the storytelling exercise, has a moment in it in which the storyteller has to turn away and not look at the people who are involved in the circle. And that's a very important element of that, because there's something about how that supports the hearing that's interesting. Another really fun story for me is, in the Lutheran context in which I often teach, confirmation is a really big deal, and it's not working well. And one of the things that people are starting to do around me is help. It's taking kids and building these kind of badge-based programs, kind of like Boy Scouts or something, where you have to accomplish certain things. And one of the things that has proven very effective, I love this story, is to ask students going through the program to find somebody in their congregation who's at least 40, 40, years older than they are and not a member of their family, and to interview them and to record it on their phone. And something about having the device in the middle, because the young person's really familiar with it, the older person often doesn't understand how it works, something about that mediates a different kind of conversation. And they've had lots of experiences where they will tell kids, okay, what are you gonna ask them? Well, ask them what their favorite hymn is. So, you know, you get a kid asking somebody about a favorite hymn, and the hymn they hear about is one they hate and is boring and whatever. But when they've heard the story about why it matters to somebody, now they've built context around it. Now all of a sudden that song means something in a different way. So I think there's actually lots of possibilities for this kind of thing if we can just, be honest about it.
Thanks, Mary, for a really beautiful presentation. One of the things I was thinking about in the story sharing, especially in digital spaces, is how you were contrasting the consumption and the creation. And one of the things that I've been noticing recently, and you probably have some thoughts on this, is the commodification of stories.
Yeah.
So, you know, whether it's StoryCorps or WASP, or not WASP, Moth.
Right.
The Moth Radio Hours. Or something like that. The stories become, at least the way I'm experiencing them as the person at the side of the radio, as performative.
Yeah.
And it's not so much focusing on the receiving of the story, but as one more performance. And I think you must have some thoughts about that delicate balance between when is a story authentic and powerful and focusing on the receiving, and when is it like, here's one
right.
more production.
And this is where context collapse matters so hugely, because part of what you're talking about in the ways in which it's been commodified, it's lost some of that original context, right? Which includes some of the actual being in the room, honing the story together kind of piece. But I also, I think for the most part, I actually appreciate what Moth Radio Hour is doing in StoryCorps, because part of what they're doing is making it possible for people to tell stories and share them out. And they tend not to be dominant stock stories. They tend to be more of at least the concealed stories, sometimes more of the resistant stories. And I would just say that one of the things we need to think about when we're talking about the stories at the heart of our faith tradition, which, excuse me, are very powerful and epic, and right, is how we have people. That's why, for me, I don't know what you did with that commercial. When I use that commercial in settings, people will often talk to me about things like table fellowship and table fellowship with the disciples, or the story of Jesus saying, "Let the little child come to me," unless you're like a child. So those are the kinds of resonances that emerge for people, and this is why when you do that kind of work, you have to have somebody in the room who actually knows some of the biblical stories, right? Because you can have a lovely conversation about that kind of television commercial, but if nobody in the room has any connection at all to a religious tradition, it's not going to do the work I'm talking about in terms of getting you into that. But this is where context collapse is so hard, because what you or I might experience as kind of the commodification of that process, for some people, is a deeply authentic piece. I mean, this is where we get into trouble, right, with all of our ideological polarization, because stories matter so much in how people determine what is authentic to them. I was explaining to somebody earlier, I'll betray my political sensibilities here, President Trump is in my hometown tonight. There's a lot of worry about what that's going to mean in terms of the protests in Minneapolis. But I teach at a seminary where our student body is drawn from evangelical conservative spaces as much as it is from progressive Protestant spaces. So we have kind of this back and forth, which means we still have some conversations. And some of the more interesting, heartbreaking conversations for me have been the ones between some of my pastor friends who've gone down to the Texas border and come back with stories, and some of my conservative friends who will say to them, "No, what you saw is not what you say you saw. What you saw is children being rescued because they're being used as pawns from gangs who abducted them from their families and brought them to the States," right? So you've got competing stories here, and in both of those stories, the adults are helping the children. In my story, it's the pastors going down trying to help families reunite. In the conservative story, it's the U.S. government protecting children who have been taken, right? So that's the place in which we're inhabiting such different realities that I begin to wonder, how are we even present in that? And that's where I'm back to, okay, how do we hear each other in that? Can we start with what our own particular experiences are, even if they contradict what we think we know? Because if we can't do that, then... One of my favorite books, which is on the handout, I quoted her earlier, Irshad Manji, has a book called Don't Label Me, an incredibly something conversation for divided times. It's a really interesting book. I commend it to you. Anyway. Other questions? Is there one over there? Last one. Okay, this is the last one, Megan tells me. Sorry.
Thank you for your presentation. It's given me a lot to think about. One question that I had was about the sort of prior work that would need to be done. I'm envisioning people, particularly when you spoke about people who've experienced trauma, and I'm wondering about the willingness to share a story and trust, being able to say, once I put my story out there, I have to trust that you're going to receive it at least with respect and openness. And so I'm wondering about what kind of preparatory work you need to
do. That's a really important question. Thank you for lifting it up. So a couple things. First of all, Frank Rogers' book, Finding God in the Graffiti, talks about some of that with young people. I would also commend you, I don't think I put it on the list and I should have, a book by Resma Menachem, who is a somatic counselor, therapist in the Twin Cities who works with police. I think that one of the things about trauma, right, is even being able to, as I mentioned, teaches you not to be vulnerable, not to seek vulnerability. So you have, in the context of the School of Theology and Ministry, people who are working around CPE processes, people who are doing pastoral care, people who are talking about soul discernment in those ways, soul repair, soul injury, those kinds of things. Those are really powerful resources that have made a big impression on me. I can't, in a quick answer, other than to say, absolutely yes, you're exactly right. How do we prepare the listening spaces? How do we not shame or in some way make people feel bad because they're not ready to be in that kind of space, right? That's a really important thing. And there's an awful lot of folk right now in the Roman Catholic Church who want nothing to do with the Roman Catholic Church. And that I get that. You know, I'm privileged. I'm grateful. I haven't been hurt in those ways. I can still be in that space. But there are a lot of people who cannot be, and I don't want to tell them they shouldn't, right? That's a good note on which to end, that we need to prepare carefully. Thank you so much for coming this evening.